Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you all here. I'm glad to be back. I had a wonderful vacation. It went by far too fast, as they always do. But I'm thankful to be here and be able to worship with you all. My thanks go to Bruce Hines and John Wilderspin and the worship team at First Baptist for leading worship in July while I was on holidays. I know that it was very much appreciated and everyone really enjoyed it. So I have a hard act to follow. I'd first like to acknowledge that we are worshiping today on land that has been inhabited by indigenous peoples from time immemorial. As settlers, non-indigenous people, we're grateful for the opportunity to meet here. Long before today, indigenous peoples have been the stewards of this place. We especially acknowledge the Huron-Wendat, Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, and St. Lawrence Iroquois peoples. We also note that this territory is covered by the Upper Canada Treaties. Just for the First Presbyterian Church folks, please note that coffee hour and church school do not begin again until September 17th. For the children, there are quiet activities available for them to enjoy during the service. If you can help with coffee hour starting again in September, please contact Tamara Chapman. August 6th is Loaves and Fishes Sunday here at First Presbyterian Church. So there are donations of food can be left in the basket at the rear of the sanctuary or delivered to the church office. They are especially always looking for white and chocolate cake mixes and coffee. Donations of money are also welcome in your regular offering envelopes or online donations. I had the opportunity to drop off a box of bananas that the food bank had that they were going to in danger of going overripe. So I dropped those off on Thursday and had a chance to chat with Lori and listen to some of the wonderful things that Loaves and Fishes are doing in our community to feed those who are most in need. You'll see in your bulletin there were a lot of birthdays in July and the beginning of August too. So I won't read them all, but all I can say is for everybody who had a birthday in July and the beginning of August, very happy birthday to you all. There was also, yes, I know, we need to clap for them, yes. Another trip around the sun, there you go. Ian and Mary Ellen Stevenson had their wedding anniversary on July 1st, and Hugh and Gloria Bates were on July 9th, so happy anniversary belatedly to you. I would say congratulations to the men and condolences to the women, but sorry, I'm just joking. We do have some birthdays coming up this week, though. As a matter of fact, we have one today. We have Kathleen Howard's birthday is today, August 6th. And then she's followed by Elizabeth Robinson, her daughter, whose birthday is on August 10th, along with Isabel McDonald and Nellie Landon. So very happy birthday to all of our birthday people today. We would like to extend our love and sympathy to Shirley Hall on the death of her daughter, Catherine, on Wednesday, June 26th. The Reverend Susan Clark conducted the service in memory of Catherine on Wednesday, August 2nd in the chapel at Irvin Funeral Home. So please do remember Catherine's family in your prayers. We'd also like to extend our love and sympathy to Perry, Peter, Andrew, and Stephen Sine on the death of their mother, Audrey Sine. That was announced last week. At Hilltop Manor in Merrickville. I will be conducting the funeral service in memory of Audrey on this coming Tuesday, August 8th at 11 o'clock in the chapel at Irvin Funeral Home. So please do remember the Sine family in your prayers. Note the worship schedule for the rest of August into September, and also for those First Presbyterian Church folks, the challenge newsletter will be coming out in mid-September. So please drop off all those stories and pictures of all the things that you've been doing this summer. And I know you've been doing a lot of things this summer because I've been seeing things on Facebook. So please drop off hard copies outside the church office or send submissions by email by September 5th. It's not in the bulletin yet, but the Night Train Big Band is back. Michelle Labonte, our sound technician up there of our congregation, he plays in the band. They're having their first concert in 4 years since the pandemic on Wednesday, August 23rd at 7 p.m. in Winchester at the United Church there on a pay-what-you-can basis. You may contact the church office for more information or speak to Michelle and mark your calendars for that event. There are many other items in the bulletin, so I'd encourage you to read through them if you haven't already, and I'd also ask you to please check our website, our social media accounts, for the latest information on what's happening here at First Presbyterian Church. Let us now begin our service today with the call to worship, which is in your bulletin and also available to our folks on live stream. So let us worship together. We are children of God learning to walk. Day by day, we are learning to be the church. God is a loving parent teaching us to walk. God loves us, leads us, and feeds us. Our opening hymn is number 366, Jesus, Thou Joy of Loving Hearts. You're welcome to stand in body or in spirit for the singing of this hymn. I invite you to turn with me in the bulletin as we read together the prayer as we approach God, which is printed responsively. Holy One, you see us just for who we are. Yet you love us with a parent's love. Gracious God, continue to guide us and teach us to walk in your ways. Stay with us when we have need of you, O God, and bless us in our struggles, that we might be a blessing for others in need. You're invited to be seated. And then we will continue with our prayer of confession, which is also in the order of service. Parenting God, in your enduring love for us, we see both our guilt and our acquittal. Let us return to you in confession and repentance. Nurturing God, you continue to lead us in upright ways on account of your love for us. Yet we do not always follow your call. We turn away from you and go our own way. Forgive us and return us to our rightful home in you through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Friends, hear these words from our God. I cannot give up on you. My compassion grows warm and tender. When my children come trembling, I will bring them home. Believe the gospel in Jesus Christ. We all are forgiven. Amen. And now, if the children would like to come up to the front, if you want to, and moms and dads can come up too, I have a story for you. Anybody want to come up, or do you want to just, you're going to come up? Oh, Lincoln, you're going to come up? Come on. You're going to sit over here with me? You're going to sit over here with me? Okay, good morning. How are you? Are you okay? You thinking about it? Glad to be here? That's okay. I understand. Now, I had a great vacation. It was nice to have some time off for a rest. Now, have you seen these? Now, may I show you these? Did you see some of these at the cottage? Yeah? What's that?
Tomato.
That tomato, that's right. What's this? That's right. And what's this? This is big. You might not know what this one is. You know what that is? It's a squash. Yeah. One of the things did on my vacation was did lots of gardening. So I bought some tomato plants and some pepper plants and some squash plants. And I planted them in the garden. You've seen them, right? You had some of those tomatoes? Yeah? Good. They are producing lots and lots and lots of vegetables. As a matter of fact, I had to go, oh, are you going to come up? Good morning. That's okay. You want to come see the cucumber? You want to come see this cucumber? How about the tomato? You want to see the tomato? Or you can sit right at the front if you'd rather. That's okay. I understand that feeling. I understand. You can sit right there if you want. Yeah. Did you see this cucumber? Yeah? That's a cucumber, and it's a tomato, and a squash. I've had so many cucumbers, in fact. You know what I had to do with them? I had to make pickles. And I also took some of them to the food bank. I took a whole bag of them to the food bank because I had so many that I couldn't eat them all. I was giving them away to everybody I knew. Because people then who don't have something to eat can eat them. So God has given me more than enough vegetables from my garden this summer. As a matter of fact, this is the first of the squashes, so I'm going to be getting a lot more of these. So you may find a few laying around. I just had to do some work. I had to weed them and water them. But other than that, I didn't have to do anything. And God gave them all to me for free. Everything was free. Free, free, free. And our scripture passage today from Isaiah tells us that God gives us gifts every day and everything is free. Free. And we don't have to pay for it. Can you think of some of the gifts that God gives us every day? What sorts of things? Maybe your mom? Maybe mom and dad? You love them? Maybe the lake? The water, that's free. What about the sunshine? Is that free? Yeah. What about your other family and friends? All free, right? All free, that's right. And the greatest gift that God ever gave us was Jesus. And God gives us so much every day, and it's all free. Okay, so can we pray? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for all the gifts you give us. You always give us more than enough. Help us to remember and be grateful for your blessing each day. Amen. Do you want to take one of these with you, or do you want to take one? You want one? Remember, I have lots of these cucumbers. I have more. You want a cucumber? There you go. Good morning. How are you? There you go. It was free. There, you're welcome. All right. Well, our next hymn is I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say, number 671. It's in your order of service and also in the hymn book. And again, you're always welcome to stand or sing in body or in spirit and be seated for the singing of this hymn. 671. Please be seated. Now I'll invite Cade LeBrun to come forward. Cade's going to read for us our responsive psalm and our scripture passage, which are in your order of service.
The psalm we'll be reading today is Psalm 145, 8 through 9, and 14 to 21. The Lord is gracious and merciful.
The Lord is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
The Lord is good to all.
And your compassion is over all creation.
All the words of the Lord are faithful. All the deeds of the Lord are gracious.
The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, satisfying the desire of every living thing.
All the ways of the Lord are just. All the doings of the Lord are kind.
The Lord is near to all who call, to all who call on the Lord in truth. The Lord fulfills the desire of all who show reverence. The Lord hears their cry and saves them.
All who love the Lord preserves. All the wicked, the Lord will destroy.
My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless God's holy name forever and ever.
Today's scripture lesson is Isaiah 55, verses 1 through 5. Come, all who are thirsty, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me, and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest of fare. Give ear and come to me. Listen, that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. See, I have made him a witness to the peoples, a ruler and commander of all peoples. Surely you will summon nations you know not, and nations you do not know will come running to you. Because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, he has endowed you with splendor. For the word in God in Scripture, for the word of God within us, and for the word of God around us.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Kathleen actually had the hard part. Did you hear all the, those moving notes underneath? It's like, whoa. Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts and minds fill us. And as we hear your word for us today, remind us that we have been raised with Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Most of us, I would venture to say, resent invitations to meals with strings attached. Thanks, but no thanks. Invitations to meals and banquets occur several times in the Bible, and they always seem to come with a hitch. The good news is that all of us are invited. The bad news is that you must bring a dish or do something. Adam and Eve, for example, were given the whole Garden of Eden for their pleasure, except for that one fruit tree that they couldn't resist. But they were also named to be caretakers of the garden, and in fact, caretakers of all creation. Jesus broke bread and poured wine, inviting all to a heavenly banquet. But the followers, his followers, were instructed to feed his sheep and tend to his lambs. Today's text is no exception, really, because all are invited to the water. But Isaiah reminds his listeners to eat the good things that matter. In our text, just to give you a bit of context, this passage was written to the Judean exiles when they were in Babylon. Those people that were in Babylon were the intelligentsia and the wealthy, and the educated, and the people who were deemed important enough to deport from Judah to the Empire of Babylon. Now, it's been a while since that happened. So several generations later, it is very likely that these exiles have prospered in their captivity, even if in limited ways. Thinking of returning to Jerusalem might have been a challenge for them. They might be thinking, how can I fit all this stuff I have in one broken down ox cart? They've accumulated goodies in Babylon. They've become used to the lifestyle and the customs of their captors. But Isaiah is reminding them where they came from. The God who was apparently absent all this time is now inviting them to come back and to rebuild that project that he gave them so long ago, that idea of abundant life for everyone. And the new Judah will look nothing like the flamboyant Babylon to which they have become accustomed. Scattered and exiled communities abound in our world today. You only have to turn the news on to see where there's yet been another war or conflict forcing people to flee. We in Canada receive refugees from all over the world, whether they come at the invitation of our government or they slip across the borders seeking asylum. For example, the recent influx of Ukrainians to Canada fleeing war and violence. Canada now has the third largest Ukrainian community in the world outside of Russia and Ukraine itself. And many of these refugees, while grateful for the peace and safety of life here, still feel their situation is one of exile. They are far from home, in a land where the cultural values they held dear are not the same as they are here. Back home, for example, they knew their neighbors. They took care of one another's children. They helped one another out in hard times and found enjoyment in simple things. Here, the consumerism of Babylon and the materialistic West surrounds them. And no doubt the same occurred with those exiles in Babylon, because they had reason to wonder if God was still around. After all, had not God's temple been destroyed? Had not Yahweh's chosen people been pillaged and humiliated and exiled? To them, or at least what they thought, Yahweh had lost. Those flashy gods of Babylon obviously were stronger, and they deserved homage. So why not live a little and consume as everybody else did? Eat those fast foods, buy those golden calf lottery tickets, get sucked into the television set and social media while watch another sporting event. Ignore your neighbors. They probably just want something anyway. Take care of number one. Isaiah's invitation in verses 1 and 2 today is good news for the poor. It's not necessarily bad news for the rest of us, but it's a wake-up call to put down all those gadgets that pull our attention away from God's project of life in abundance for all. And those who strive and thrive and adapted to Babylon's consumerist culture should hear words of warning, reminding them that their return to Jerusalem means putting back all those e-toys they got in Babylon to focus on much more important matters. Our concluding verses of 2 Isaiah today provide for some good things to think about during the summer, as so many of us have time to evaluate how our energy, our resources, and our time itself is spent. We might want to ask ourselves, are we so caught up in Babylon's gadgets and information overload that we're left empty inside? Or are we spending our money on the energies on the life projects that God is calling us to join? God's banquet invitation, as extended by Isaiah today, is uncomfortable in one sense, because those without money, who sometimes smell and talk and behave differently from us, and those with money, well, they're both invited, because there's no A-list or B-list in this invitation. Instead, God asks us to just show up and eat with others. While most of us prefer to eat and worship with those with whose income and status are like ours, this is not what God has as a vision of life, and it's not what Isaiah is telling us today. Verse 3, I think, might have stung the exiled community in Babylon. Give ear and come to me. Listen, that you may live. And they might be forgiven for asking, who's this Yahweh now to show up and say these words? Have you not abandoned and forgotten us for generations, Yahweh? Come on. What do you mean, come to you? You come to us. Often when we suffer injustice or illness, God seems to be nowhere to be found, doesn't he? We conclude that God has jumped ship or is merely a fantasy we created when times were good. We move on to other gods, whether it's money or e-toys or other things that this society throws at us. But in these verses, God reminds us that we're part of something that is much bigger, and that God is, in spite of what we think, very much involved. We learn yet again that God's recovery methods involve working alongside us, and working alongside those who suffer, promising presence, but not doing all the work God's self. God expects us to be involved too. This text today reminds the Judean captives, and reminds us as well, that the project God began all those centuries ago, millennia really, continues. And this insignificant, humiliated people will not just survive, they will be a light to others. Surrounded by other, more powerful and richer countries, Yahweh's people will be looked to by many other nations for the kind of society they create in covenant with God. And this covenant will be based on protecting the weakest members of society, controlling greed among the more powerful, and breaking down walls that divide rich and poor. Those without money and those with money will sit together and worship the same God who created them. It's the way they live and treat one another, not how many ox carts they can fill. And when you think about it today, not how many things we can put in our houses. That makes them and us a light to others. And while that definition was from so long ago, from Isaiah, it still is meaningful and important for us today, because this is God's definition of life, real life, in abundance. Amen. Let us pray. Fed on the wisdom of God's word today, let us strive toward the goal of seeing God face to face. May God touch our minds with understanding, that we may sense Christ's presence in the struggles and the wounds and the joys and the sorrows of this life. And please let us learn to share what we have in abundance. Amen. Our next hymn is 682, Just As I Am Without One Plea. Again, you're invited to stand in body or in spirit for the singing of this hymn.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I invite you now to turn in your order of service to the prayers of the people, followed by which are responsive, followed by the Lord's Prayer. You'll see there is a response for the people, so please do speak up where indicated. Let us now come to the God who loves us, who gives to us every day freely with so much gifts and blessings. Let us come to God in prayer. Loving God, we are much in need of your guidance today. When we wobble and fall, stand us up and help us walk again with cords of human kindness and bonds of love. Lord, teach us your ways of love. We pray for the church and for all who teach others with kindness, firm guidance, and love. Lord, teach us your ways of love. We pray for your peace among nations and peace between people, praying especially for Ukraine, Afghanistan, Syria, Sudan, Eritrea, Niger, and Israel-Palestine. Lord, teach us your ways of love. We pray for those suffering the calamities of nature and the effects of climate change, praying especially for those impacted by flooding, storm, and wildfires. Show us how to tread lightly upon the earth and care for your creation as you want us to do. Lord, teach us your ways of love. We pray for all those in need, including those who are struggling with homelessness and poverty, including women and children fleeing domestic violence. Lord, teach us your ways of love. We pray for those who are ill, their families and their caregivers, praying for our healthcare system, our healthcare workers, and for those who are awaiting treatment or surgery. Help us to support them with our love and prayer. Lord, teach us your ways of love. We pray for those who refuse to give, who have more than enough but choose to build new barns in which to hoard, instead of to help. Lord, teach us your ways of love. Loving God, through Jesus Christ, you nurture and nourish us. You love us with an everlasting love, low and high, rich and poor together. Renew us in your call and release us from all fear, that we may heed these things and consider your steadfast love for all, shown through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus Christ, God warns us against storing up riches for ourselves. Let us consider these things and give as the Spirit directs us. As you'll see in the bulletin, there are ways that you can give to support the church and its ministries here. There also are visitor envelopes in the pew if you need a visitor envelope, and you can please feel free to fill it out and drop it in the offering plate, which will be coming up the aisle soon. If you want to put it here later on, you're welcome to do that. However you give and whatever you can give, we thank you for your generosity and support of both First Presbyterian Church and First Baptist Church as we are worshiping together today as we have this summer. So let us now stand to sing the offering praise song, Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Thank you.
Holy One, we give you thanks today for the richness of our lives. Bless these, our gifts and offerings, that they may be used as expressions of your faithful love for those in need, near and far. Amen. And our closing hymn is number 699, All the Way My Savior Leads Me. And now may we be raised with Christ into the things that are above. May we strip off our old selves and clothe ourselves in the new self that is renewed in the image of our Creator. And may we find community, ourselves in the community of the Holy Spirit, where there is no longer Jew or Gentile, religious and non-believer, conservative and liberal, rich and poor, but where Christ is all in all. And may the grace, peace, and love of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen. Seated for the postlude.